Begin with a word of prayer, and then we'll jump into our discussion for this particular workshop. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time that we can share together. I pray that it would be a time of encouragement, and Lord, I pray again for the entire Compassionate Boldness Conference, that it would be a time in which believers are encouraged and blessed, and in turn can take that message of salvation complete in Christ out to a world that's lost, some who are religious and others who are irreligious. But use us, Lord, to magnify that name that is above every name, the name of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to be talking about Mormonism's charge that there was a universal apostasy and that there needed to be a restoration. They've made some rather serious charges against historic Christianity. And we're going to be responding to that as well as some of their... Pardon? A little closer? Or not as close? There, okay. All right. Hopefully we get it where you can hear. But they've made some unique claims for themselves as well as some serious charges against historic Christianity. And we're going to respond to some of those charges. I would remind you that Christianity was around for better than 1,800 years when Joseph Smith came on the scene and charged the church with apostasy, that there was no true church on the earth. And so I believe that we have an obligation, actually, to contend earnestly for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints, as Jude verse 3 says. And I think we can do that in a spirit, as Paul says in Ephesians 4, verse 15, we can speak the truth in love as we do that. But this charge that there was a universal apostasy says something about our Lord as well as about the church that he built. Some time ago, a couple of Mormon missionaries called at my home and introduced themselves as missionaries of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And they said they were just calling in the area and wondered if I was a member of the church. And I responded by saying, yes, I'm a member of the true church. And they said, what church is that? And I said, it's the one the Bible talks about. You do believe the Bible, don't you? And they said, well, yes, but we wondered if you were a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And I said, well, not anymore. I used to be. And they looked a little shocked, and then they said, well, what do you think of the church? And I said, a lot of nice people in it, but you know, I just can't buy the premise that it began with. And they said, what's that? And I said that Jesus Christ blew it. And they said, what are you talking about? And I said, Jesus very plainly said in Matthew 16, 18, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But Joseph Smith and his successors have claimed that that church was prevailed against and it ceased to exist. So I can either believe what Jesus said or what Joseph and his successors said, but I can't believe both. I said, why don't you come on in and let's discuss it? But they were too busy and said they'd maybe come back another day. I'm still waiting for them. But at any rate, what is that church that I said I belong to, that true church that I said I belong to? You realize that Jesus used the word church only three times. One is in the text that I already mentioned, Matthew 16, 18, where he said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And the other two times are in Matthew 18, verse 17, where it's talking about if somebody offends, they're to be brought before the church. And it's mentioned twice in that verse. That's the only three times that Jesus used the word church. But, of course, the disciples, the writers of the New Testament, used it many more times. But what is the church? The church is introduced to us in the Bible, so it's the Bible that must define what it is. It comes from the Greek word ekklesia, which literally means an assembly or a congregation, an orderly gathering of people. And it comes from two other Greek words, ek and kaleo, to call out. So the church is really a called out people, called out of the world into a fellowship of believers in Jesus Christ. That's what the church is. And Ephesians 1, 22 and 23 give us some idea about the church, where it says, God hath put all things under his feet and given him, that is Christ, to be head over all things to the church, which is his body. That's what the church is. It's his body. But that definition is vastly different than the one in the book called Restoration of All Things by Joseph Fielding Smith on page 76 and 77, where he says, what is the church? And then he said, it is a divinely organized government with offices and unchangeable laws whose king is Jesus Christ. Its purpose is to bring to pass the salvation and exaltation of its citizens through their obedience to its divine laws. He goes on to say, a study of history shows that the organization of the church as it was in the days of Jesus Christ and his apostles was not found on the earth when Joseph Smith went to inquire of the Lord. That's at his first vision. Well, several things are wrong with Joseph Fielding Smith's statement. First of all, the word church had already been defined at least 1,800 years before he gave his definition, and he gave it a whole different meaning. Where in the Bible do you find that the church is a divinely organized government established to bring salvation to people through obeying its divine laws? Where is that definition in the Bible? It's not. It never was there. The church was not designed to be our Savior. Jesus came to be our Savior. That's why he is called Savior and the church is not. Well, so what does Mormonism teach about this universal apostasy of the church that Jesus said he would build? Well, I think you all know the story. In 1820, supposedly, according to the official version, he had his first vision. But that vision was not published, as it is now recorded in the official record of that account, until 1842. And between 1820 and 1842, there were 22 years in which he told different accounts of that first vision. We don't have time to go into those today, but we'll look just at the first vision, which does deal with the great apostasy. Even though it doesn't use those words, it certainly is there. The basis of their universal apostasy is in their scripture, in the Pearl of Great Price, Joseph Smith history. The account basically covers verses 5 to 20. When Joseph said he was 14 years of age, and in his area there in Palmyra, New York, there was a big revival going on, and each one of the churches claiming they were right and the others were wrong, and he was confused by that, so he read the Bible in James 1:5. He found that verse that says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberty and abradeth not, and it shall be given to him. So he went to God in prayer and asked for knowledge, not wisdom. He asked, what church is right? What church should I join? And he says that the Father and Son appeared above him in the light, and the Father said, here's my Son, hear him. And he asked that question, which of all the churches are right, and which should I join? He said, I was answered, I must join none of them, for they were all wrong. And the person who addressed me said that all their creeds were an abomination, that those professors were all corrupt. That's the basis of the universal apostasy. And if you think that Mormonism has changed that, you're sadly mistaken. It's still in their scripture. And the other day I took somebody down to Temple Square. They wanted to see it, and we were handed this pamphlet that has verbatim the same story. They haven't changed it. It still says the same thing. All the churches are wrong. All their creeds are an abomination. All the professors are corrupt. That's a sweeping statement. Now, I realize that there are Mormon apologists like Bob Millett and others who want to soften that. They realize how offensive that is to those in other churches. And it is offensive to say they're all wrong, they're all corrupt, and so forth. You know, this is supposed to be the Lord who is omniscient, who makes this statement about the church. That's what Joseph Smith says. But notice those words carefully. You would think that the omniscient Lord would know what these words mean. When he asked the question, which church is right and which should I join, he says, I was answered by the omniscient Lord that they're all wrong. Not some of them, but all of them are wrong. And all their creeds are an abomination. All the professors are corrupt. Now, what does wrong mean? Just so that I wouldn't misstate it, I looked it up in the dictionary. And wrong means that it's not right, it's bad, or false. That's what wrong means. Then when he said all, not some, of their creeds are an abomination. What does abomination mean? Well, abomination means abhorrent, disgusting, shamefully wicked, according to the dictionary. And it's all of their creeds are like that. Now, what's a creed? A creed is a summary statement of essential beliefs or doctrines of a church based on the Bible. And he says all of them are an abomination. And then he says that all of those who are professors, those who profess to believe it, all of them are corrupt. And what does corrupt mean? Well, it means they are evil, wicked, or dishonest. So with that kind of definition, can we say that it really didn't mean that? That it didn't mean what it said? It's like is didn't mean is a few years ago, you know? All doesn't mean all, doesn't mean they're all corrupt and so forth. Now, the problem with trying to explain it away is it flies in the face of all that Mormonism has been teaching since its inception. You can go to their scripture, for example. I think Bill McKeever referred to 1 Nephi 14:10 last night, which says, behold, there are save two churches only. The one is the church of the Lamb of God, and the other is the church of the devil. If they are the church of the Lamb of God, then what are all the other churches? Well, they're apparently of the devil. In the Doctrine and Covenants, section 1, verse 30, which Smith said he got November 1st of 1831, a little over a year and a half after he started the church, he's told that the church he's starting is the only true and living church upon the face of the whole earth. Well, if it's the only true church on the face of the whole earth, what are all the others? False. So, yes, as far as all other churches are concerned, that's a slap in the face. It is insulting to all other churches. Joseph Fielding Smith, the 10th prophet, wrote in Religious Truths Defined, page 169, that this was not a partial apostasy, it was complete. That makes it universal. There was no church of God on earth with authority to act in his name. So he says there was no real church as far as the New Testament Christianity was concerned in Joseph Smith's day. We have statements by other Mormon leaders like Orson Pratt in the Journal of Discourses, volume 13, page 125, when he says that Jesus made his appearance on the earth in the meridian of time, and he established his kingdom on the earth. But to fulfill ancient prophecies, the Lord suffered that kingdom to be uprooted. In other words, the kingdoms of this world made war against the kingdom of God established 18 centuries ago, and they prevailed against it, and the kingdom ceased to exist. The great beast that John saw made war with it and prevailed against it. I think it's interesting that Pratt uses the same word that's in the King James Version of the Bible in Matthew 16, 18. And remember, the King James is their official Bible. But there Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Those are the very words that Orson Pratt used when he said the church was prevailed against. Again, in The Seer, Orson Pratt said this about the church. But who in this generation have authority to baptize? None but those who received authority in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. All other churches are entirely destitute of all authority from God, and any person who receives baptism or the Lord's Supper will highly offend God. And he says, for he looks upon them as the most corrupt of all people. Both Catholics and Protestants are nothing less than the whore of Babylon, whom the Lord denounces by the mouth of John the Revelator as having corrupted all the earth by their fornication and wickedness. And any person who shall be so wicked as to receive a holy ordinance of the gospel from the ministers of any of these apostate churches will be sent down to hell with them unless they repent of their unholy and impious act. Page 255 of The Seer. So Mormonism has made a rather serious attack on all other churches. But, you know, they haven't always been careful in using other sources to try to prove that the apostasy was a reality. And some of you are probably old enough to remember a few years ago they had some lighted murals down on Temple Square in the Visitor's Center. And the mural had the contents of this pamphlet that they handed out by the millions, the falling away and restoration foretold. And one of the things that caught my attention years ago was they quoted Martin Luther. They had a picture of him, and they quote him in large type here, "Christianity has ceased to exist." And then they give the actual quote in smaller type below, where Luther said, supposedly, "I simply say that Christianity has ceased to exist among those who should have preserved it, period." But there was no period there in what Luther said. I looked it up in the original reference, and it says that Christianity has ceased to exist among those who should have preserved it, the bishops and scholars. That is, the religious leaders and those who supposedly should have been studying the scriptures to know it. But he didn't say the church itself had ceased to exist. In fact, the Mormon leaders knew that. Joseph Fielding Smith himself says in Religious Truths Defined, page 167, "Luther and other reformers claimed that their doctrines and authority went back to the apostles. They believed that the church had been continued from the time of Christ by the faithful known only to God." So they knew that. So why were they putting this kind of stuff out to deceive people? And that's all it is deception, to try to get them to believe that others saw what Mormonism saw concerning this great apostasy. Well, there's a lot said about the apostasy. If you have the seven-volume church history, B.H. Roberts is the one that edited that in the first volume. In the introduction on page 39, he says, "Saddening as the thought may seem, the church founded by the labors of Jesus and his apostles was destroyed from the earth. The gospel was perverted, its ordinances were changed, its laws were transgressed, its covenant was on the part of man broken, and the world was left to flounder in the darkness of a long period of apostasy." And then, of course, you have Talmage's book called The Great Apostasy in the preface of that. He says, "The evidence of the decline and final extinction of the primitive church is found in scriptural record and in secular history." He doesn't give any references there, but he makes that statement, the final extinction. I hope you know what extinct means. It's non-existent. There was no true church on the earth as far as Talmage was concerned. Now, to support their teaching of a universal apostasy, Mormons do cite some Bible texts, and I don't have time to deal with them today, but if you're ever challenged about it, be careful. Read them all in their context. Many of them don't even refer to the church, and none of them say anything about a universal apostasy. You realize that Mormons use the King James Version of the Bible, and in that King James Version of the Bible, you don't even have the word apostasy, let alone universal apostasy. It's not there. Now, I'm not saying that the scripture doesn't teach that there would be some who would depart from the faith. There's always been apostates. But a universal apostasy is not taught in the Bible. I don't care how many scriptural texts they use, it's not there. So what does the Bible say about a universal apostasy? In a word, nothing. But in Matthew 16:18, Jesus made that statement, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Who is the one that made that statement? That's the Lord Jesus. And who is the Lord Jesus? Well, according to Scripture, he is God. I think you heard that in the plenary session just before this. Jesus is God. That's what 1 Timothy 3:16 says. God was manifest in the flesh. John chapter 1, verse 1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Verse 14, "And the Word," capital W-O-R-D, "the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." That's the Lord Jesus. Hebrews 1:8, "Unto the Son, the Father said, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever." That's the one who said, "I will build my church." God, who was manifest in the flesh, made that statement. Now, I think God probably has enough power to do what he said he would do. As a matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18, what did he say? "All power is given to me in heaven and in earth." All power. Revelation 19:6 says, the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. What is omnipotence? The one with all power. So if the one with all power, who is God, said, I will build my church, do you think he can do it? If he can't, we can't trust anything that he said. But he said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Did he do it? You all know the story of his crucifixion, his death, burial, and resurrection, and how in Acts chapter 1, verse 9, he ascended up into glory as the disciples watched him go. But what is Acts chapter 2, the very last verse, verse 47, what does it say? And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved, or those that were being saved. So he said, I'll build my church, and even though he had already ascended into glory, he was doing what he said he would do, building the church, and he's still doing that today. Now, the New Testament uses a number of analogies to help us to understand the relationship between Christ and his church. We've made reference earlier to what Paul wrote in Ephesians 1:22 and 23, that God gave him, Christ, to be head over all things to the church, which is his body. Now, where was Jesus when that statement was made? He'd already ascended into glory. But the church is, present tense, his body. And he is head over all things to the church, as Colossians 1, 16 through 18 says. In that passage, I hope you've studied it carefully. In Colossians chapter 1, 16 to 18, it says, for by him, that is Christ, all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or power, all things were made by him and for him, and by him all things consist or are held together, and he is the head of the body, the church. That's the context. Immediately after saying by him all things are held together, he is the head of the body, the church. So if he made all things and all things are held together by him, and immediately he says, and he's the head of the body, the church, isn't that included, the church? I believe it is. So he is able to keep the church together. Now, Christ is inseparable from his body, the church. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 to 27, it says that Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Notice, he loved the church. He loved the church, and he gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, having not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Now, we haven't arrived yet to that last part where we're without blemish, but we'll be there because that's the kind of church he's producing. The first part of it is where we're at now, that he might cleanse and sanctify it with the washing of water by the word. As the word is applied to our lives, we are being sanctified daily, and we will ultimately be what he intended for us to be. So he didn't give himself to produce an apostate church, but a holy church without spot or wrinkle. That's what he gave himself for. In Ephesians 5:29, in that same chapter that we just referred to, it says, no man ever yet hated his own body, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. Now you have a body, I have a body. It says, no man ever yet hated his own body, but he nourishes it. What does that mean? He feeds it. You probably ate today. And he cherishes it. He lovingly cares for it. You put clothes on and you take care of the other creature needs that we have. And he says, no man ever yet hated his own body, but he nourishes or feeds and he lovingly cares for it, just as the Lord, the church, because the church is his body. Did you catch that? No man ever yet hated his own flesh, but he nourishes and cherishes it, even as, even as the Lord, the church. So he's the one taking care of it. So if it went into apostasy, are you going to point the finger of blame at him? That's a pretty serious charge to make. Well, Paul didn't expect the church to become universally apostate when he prayed in Ephesians 3:21 that glory would be in the church throughout all ages, world without end. Even back in the Old Testament, the psalmist in Psalm 100 and verse 5 says, "The Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations." And he didn't make an exception for, you know, the great apostasy. But his truth endures to all generations. In both the Old Testament and New Testament, the Lord's people are called sheep. And in John 10, verse 3, the Lord calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. Verse 4 goes on to say, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him. Well, did he lead them away into apostasy? I don't think so. It goes on in verse 11 of that same chapter, John 10. And Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. Well, if the good shepherd gives his life for the sheep, he must really care for them. So when Mormonism says he lost all of his sheep, he's not only sheepless, but he's not a shepherd, because the sole purpose of a shepherd is to tend the flock. But he loved them sufficiently that he won't allow them, if they're really his sheep, to ever be lost. He goes on to say that in the same chapter in verses 27 to 29. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father who gave them to me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. That's what he said about his sheep. And there's no room in that kind of a context for Jesus to lose his flock. Well, there's several other symbolic usages of symbolism to show the connection between Christ and the church, not only the sheep and the shepherd, but we're the bride and he's the bridegroom. He's the vine, we're the branches. He's the foundation and we're the building. And in all of these various symbolic usages, it's to show the close connection between Christ and his church that he loved so much that he gave his life for it. And in essence, you don't have one without the other. Remember, he's the head and we're the body. Just as your head is connected to your body, so he is connected to us. We are inseparable. So where did this doctrine of a universal apostasy and the need for restoration come from? He didn't really get it out of the Bible. Most of you who have studied Mormonism know that Joseph Smith borrowed rather liberally from all kinds of religious organizations for the things that he taught. And this is no exception. The concept of a universal apostasy and a restoration was well known throughout his area at the time that Joseph Smith was establishing Mormonism, because Alexander Campbell was teaching that. He's the one that founded the Campbellite movement. And to his credit, he never went beyond the bounds of the Bible. But Joseph Smith did. He took that concept of a universal apostasy, and what Campbell indicated was that the apostasy was so great that the Reformation didn't resolve it all, so there had to be a further restoration. And so that's where this concept of apostasy and restoration came from. I became more keenly aware of that as a young Christian. Shortly after I left Mormonism and became a Christian, I was looking for a Bible college to go to because I wanted to study the Bible more, and I found there was a Christian college, and I said, well, I'm a Christian, so I'm going to go to that college. It's a Christian college. It happened to be one of the Campbellite colleges that follow the teachings of Alexander Campbell, and I began to hear about the apostasy and restoration, something that I was very familiar with as a former Mormon. And I thought, well, there must be some connection there somehow. And I began to look into it a little bit more, and I remembered that Sidney Rigdon was a Camelite preacher in Kirtland, Ohio, when Joseph Smith brought his little flock down from New York, and Rigdon took most of his flock into the church that Joseph Smith was establishing. And you remember what it was called at that time? It was called the Church of Christ. I want you to notice some things I jotted down that I see as similarities that Smith borrowed from Campbell. Campbell taught that the church had apostatized during the Dark Ages, and the Reformation didn't resolve that, so it had to be restored. And that's basically what Smith was teaching. Campbell rejected all the historic Christian creeds and confessions, and Smith said all their creeds are an abomination in his sight. Campbell relied on Acts 2:38 in teaching how one is saved. Faith, repentance, baptism, and then the reception of the Holy Spirit. You'll find those same things in the fourth article of faith in that order. He rejected faith only as a means of salvation and taught that one is not saved until he is baptized. Mormonism teaches the same thing. The fourth article says baptism by immersion for the remission of sins. Campbell rejected all denominational names and used only names like the Church of Christ or Christian Church. The original name of the Mormon Church was the Church of Christ. Campbell had weekly communion service without using alcoholic wine, and because he was a total abstainer, and Smith did the same thing. Campbell's goal was to have one Christian church where all Christians were a part of that organization. That was Smith's goal as well, the one true church. Now, strangely, today I hear some in evangelical circles talking that way again, that we should all be one organization. After all, didn't Jesus pray in John 17 that they may be one? And of course, it never says one organization. But what I see the Bible teaching in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3 is the unity of the Spirit and the unity of the faith. I happen to be a Baptist by my attachment now as far as that's concerned, but I have had greater fellowship sometimes with believers in other churches, because it isn't the denomination that makes us one. It's the unity of the faith and the unity of the Spirit. And if we lose sight of that, we've lost sight of what Scripture teaches. Well, there was a fellow named George Arbaugh that some of you may have read his books. He researched Mormonism, and several years ago he wrote a couple of books. One of them was God, Sex, and Saints. On page 10, he says, Mormonism, in a sense, is a split-off of the Camelite Church. He saw that there was such a close connection that he considered a split-off. He felt that Mormonism began essentially as a Camelite church, but then Smith, as he got more and more revelations, moved farther and farther away from historic Christianity. Well, Mormonism's doctrine of the restored church is that it was necessary to restore the New Testament church because it had been lost. But when you restore something, you put it back in its original condition. Yet in the Mormon Church today, you have a first presidency, patriarch, high priest, stake presidency, ward bishopric, counselors to the stake president, ward bishops, teachers, priests, and on, none of which were a part of the original church of New Testament days. So Mormonism is not a restoration. It might be a substitution, but it's not a restoration. Now, again, they use some Bible verses to prove the restoration, but again, I would say the same thing about those verses as the ones about the apostasy. Read them carefully in their context. Some of them don't even refer to the church. And again, none of them indicate that the church was gone from the earth and needed to be brought back. And the reason for that is the church never left. Jesus said he would build it, and it remained, as he said. But you know, even Mormon scripture denies universal apostasy. In the Pearl of Great Price, Moses chapter 5, verses 58 and 59, it says that the gospel began to be preached from the beginning, and it goes on to say that the gospel would be preached until the end thereof, and thus it was. Amen. So if it was preached in the beginning and it would be preached to the end of the world, where is there room for universal apostasy? In section 7 of the Doctrine and Covenants, I think probably many of you are aware that John supposedly prayed, Lord, give me power over death that I may bring live and bring souls to thee. And the Lord supposedly said to him, thou shalt tarry until I come in my glory, and thou shalt prophesy before nations, kindreds, tongues, and people who dwell on the earth. Well, supposedly he's doing that. But I don't know where he is, or I don't know where any of his converts are. But if he is doing that, then you cannot have a universal apostasy. And Joseph Smith, in Volume 1 of the History of the Church, page 176, claimed that in his day, John was then ministering to the 10 lost tribes. So he believed, or at least said, that John was ministering to the 10 lost tribes at that time. In 3 Nephi 11 of the Book of Mormon, you have the account of Jesus after he ascended up into glory from being with his disciples in Palestine. He came down to America, and he chose 12 apostles here, even though he had 12 over in Israel. So he had not 12 apostles, but 24 apostles. And three of those here in America, the American apostles, he promised them that they wouldn't die. They might be translated or something, but they would live and bring souls to Jesus until he returned in his glory and until the judgment day. 3 Nephi 28, verses 7 and 40 say, and it says that they will minister to all the people, uniting as many to the church as would believe. They're preaching, baptizing them, and as many as were baptized did receive the Holy Ghost. And verse 29 goes on to say, they preached the gospel to all the scattered tribes of Israel and unto all nations. All nations, all nations, kindreds, tongues, and people. I have asked repeatedly, can you show me one person who came into the church or came to Christ or got baptized by one of these guys? I'd like to meet one. I find no evidence of that. But if it is true, if this is really true, you cannot have a universal apostasy with, well, actually four apostles of Christ on the earth preaching the gospel, bringing souls to Jesus. It just is a flat-out contradiction. Well, Mormons also want to identify the true church by its name. And they say his true church should have his name in it. But when I look in the New Testament, I don't find that to be the case. The believers in the New Testament were called Nazarenes, Acts 24:5. Saints, Philippians 1:1. The way, Acts 22, verse 4. Believers in 1 Timothy 4:12. And the church itself was called the Church of God, or Churches of God, nine times. It's called the Church of the Firstborn once. It's called the Churches of Christ once. And the church at such and such a place a few times. But it is never, even once, called the Church of Jesus Christ. Not even once. So that was not the issue. The issue was not what they were called. In fact, the name Christians itself was given to them in derision by those who opposed the followers of Christ. They didn't choose to be called Christians. That's what somebody else called them. So that wasn't the issue. The issue for the New Testament saints was the message itself. As the Apostle Paul says in Galatians 1, though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed, anathema, damned. So it's the message, not what you're called, that counts. Well, Mormons talk a lot about other things that identify the true church, and one of those is the priesthood. You know, they've got the true priesthood of God, and oftentimes they'll use John 15:16. I don't know how many times I've had them use that passage. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. But they stop there. And they say that's where the apostle were ordained to the priesthood. But they don't even finish the verse. The verse goes right on to say that you should go and bring forth fruit, and the fruit should remain. It says absolutely nothing about priesthood. It's talking about spiritual fruit. Well, they use other texts like Hebrews 5:4, no man taketh this honor unto himself, but he is called of God, as was Aaron. And then they jump back to Exodus chapter 28, verse 1, where Moses was to call Aaron and have him function in the priest's office and so forth. But they overlook the fact that in Exodus 4, verse 28, God himself spoke to Aaron and called him. And by the way, in order to be a priest in the Old Testament, there were three things that were absolutely necessary. One, you had to be an Israelite. Secondly, you had to be of the tribe of Levi. And thirdly, you had to be of the family of Aaron, because the Aaronic priesthood is named after Aaron. It was an inherited office. You didn't get the office of an Aaronic priest by ordination. You got it because you were born in the family of Aaron. And actually, in the Doctrine and Covenants section 132 and verse 58, it says pretty much what happened to Aaron in Exodus 4:28. God spoke to Aaron. And in the Doctrine and Covenants section 132 verse 58, talking about the priesthood and how you get it and so forth, it says that a man must be called by God the Father's own voice and by the voice of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. It says nothing about ordination, but that's in the Doctrine and Covenants. Well, as far as Christians are concerned, of course, we do have two priesthoods. The priesthood that belongs to all believers, 1 Peter 2:5 and 9, regardless of your age or your sex or your race, all believers have that holy or royal priesthood spoken of in 1 Peter 2, verses 5 and 9. The only other priesthood that we are related to is the Melchizedek priesthood mentioned in Hebrews 5 through 7, and there's only one person that holds that, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Hebrews 7:24, of course, it says this man, Jesus, because he lives forever, he has an unchangeable, literally untransferable priesthood. Why? Because he lives forever. That's what the verse says. He lives forever, so he doesn't have to have successors like the previous verse. Verse 23 mentions the Old Testament priests and says because they died, they had to have someone replace them. But Jesus lives forever, so he doesn't need a successor. And by the way, what was the function of a priest? He was a go-between between man and God. He was a mediator. And what does the scripture tell us in the New Testament? 1 Timothy 2:5, there is one God and one mediator between God and men, our high priest, Jesus Christ. That's the priest that we have to be concerned about. Well, Mormonism says that another way to identify the one true church is that it's built on apostles and prophets. And of course, they didn't have 12 apostles until 5 years after they began. And on Valentine's Day of 1835, they began to get their first 12 apostles. And they got them by the witnesses of the Book of Mormon laying their hands on the heads of these men and praying prophetic prayers over their heads. And as I've said before, those prophetic prayers were full of false prophecy, and therefore the apostleship of the Mormon Church is just as valid as those false prophecies. You understand what I'm saying? You know, Jesus commended the Ephesian church in Revelation 2:2 when he said, "Thou hast tried them who say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars." We should try those who say they're apostles, because there are phonies. Paul refers to it in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 13 to 15. Such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves as the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, Satan himself can transform himself as an angel of light, so it's no great thing if his ministers appear as the ministers of righteousness. Now, if you want to read those false prophecies given over those original apostles, volume 2 of the History of the Church, page 180 through about page 200, you can read the background for it as well as the prophecies themselves, and you'll see that it's full of false prophecy. And so as far as the apostles are concerned, I believe there are only 12. You know, in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 14, it says the names of the 12 apostles are in the foundation of the city, New Jerusalem. The 12. So there were only 12. Now, I realize that Judas fell, and in Acts chapter 1, it explains all of that. He fell by prophecy and was to be replaced, and it gives, and that's the only place it gives, the qualifications of one who would function in the place of an apostle, and that qualification was he had to company with Jesus from the time that John baptized him until the same day he ascended into glory. And I submit to you, there is not a person on earth today that can meet those qualifications, and there hasn't been since the first century. There is none. Even though the Mormon Church has had about 112 apostles, not one of them meet those qualifications. None of them. And so that is not the issue. Being an apostle or having a church built on apostles was never a great issue. Jesus chose those 12 men to help him develop the ministry to start with. They had a specific job to do, and they were to be eyewitnesses of what he had done in his ministry. That's what Acts chapter 1 says. They were to be eyewitnesses of his ministry and give us what they saw. That was their purpose, and nobody today can do that. We weren't there. Well, this matter of prophets, I'm not going to say a lot about that because Sandra Tanner is going to be talking more at length about prophets, but I just remind you that Luke 16:16 says the law and the prophets were until John the Baptist. John the Baptist was the last of the great Old Testament prophets. You see, he lived and died under the old covenant because he died before Jesus died on the cross. And so the law and the prophets were until John the Baptist. And since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, it says. And then we read in Hebrews 1:1-2, God, who at sundry times and divers manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. And what did the Son say? John 12:48, the word that I have spoken is the word that will judge him or man in the last day. So what did Jesus teach? Well, one of the things that he taught, you all know, John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man will come to the Father but by me. He didn't say by my church, by my priesthood, by my laws and ordinances, but by me. He is the way. He said in John 6:47, he that believeth on me has, not will have, but has everlasting life. The great dividing line is what you do with Jesus, as John 3:16-18 says, and I trust all of you know that. First John in chapter 5, verses 11 and 12 says, this is the record that God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has life, and he that has not the Son of God has not life. That's the great dividing line. And every one of us here in this room fall into one of those categories. We either have the Son and have life, or we don't have the Son and we don't have life. I don't care how religious or irreligious we are. That's the dividing line. And that's the message that we need to convey to a lost world around us, that what people need today is Jesus Christ. It isn't some church, although I certainly do believe that you should be a part of a local congregation like this one. Wherever the Bible is taught, associated with other believers, because we're called out of the world into a fellowship of believers. But the name of it is irrelevant. The important thing is that they are believers in Jesus Christ, the one who died for our sins and was raised for our justification, who ascended to heaven and is now interceding on our behalf. People need to know him whom to know aright is life eternal.